Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We are talking about the event of the Isra wal-Mi'raj, and we are moving on to our next discussion point. We ask the question, was the Prophet ﷺ taken up to the heavens physically, or was it something he saw in his dream? So maybe he was taken up in his spirit. Some of the Muslims said that he was taken up in his spirit, others said that he was taken up in his spirit and his body. But nobody said that he just saw this vision in his dream. But most of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they say that he was taken up physically. And this is the correct opinion, because Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Subhan alladhi asra bi'abdihi. Subhan to the one who took his servant on a night journey. Now the word abd, meaning servant, doesn't just refer to the soul, it refers to the body and soul. And just in the same way where Jibreel alayhi salam came and split the chest open and washed out the heart of the Prophet, this wasn't just in a spiritual sense, this was an actual physical event. Also, we find that the mushrikeen disbelieved the Prophet because they found it impossible that somebody could be taken up like this physically. But if we are talking spiritually in terms of the spirit, then there would be far less disbelief. The next discussion point is that these narrations of the Isra wal Mi'raj, the narrations, they speak about differing events. Some narrations only mention the Isra, which is the night journey, but without the Mi'raj, which is the ascension. And other narrations just talk about the ascension without mentioning the night journey. So to obtain the full story of the Isra wal Mi'raj, you have to combine the narrations together. So for example, one narration says that the Prophet is narrating that Jibreel came to him and he made him ride the Al-Buraq, and he was taken up to the heaven. And there's no mention of the night journey, which happened before the Mi'raj. The name of this animal, Al-Buraq, has been mentioned in some narrations. This name, where does it come from, or why is it so called? Well, firstly, it comes from Al-Barq, which is lightning, and this is because this animal will travel lightning fast. So with one step, it could travel as far as the eye can see. And it has been described as a white animal between a mule and a donkey. And the second reason is that it has a bariq, which is a shine or a luster. So it must have been a bright, white, shiny type of animal. And that is a bariq, shine or luster. We are also told in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet said, مَرَرْتُ لَيْلَةَ أُسْرِيَ بِي بِمُوسَى وَهُوَ قَائِمٌ يُصَلِّي فِي قَبْرِهِ عند الكثيب الأحمر. I passed by the grave of Musa alayhi salam on the night I was taken on the night journey, and he was standing in his grave praying near the red heap. Now most scholars accept this hadith, some scholars do not accept it. As far as the Mi'raj is concerned, the Prophet was taken up, Jibreel asked to be entered into the first heaven, and he was asked, is anyone with you? He said, yes, Muhammad ibn Abdullah is with me. And he was asked, has he been sent? Or in another wording, has he been inspired? So in other words, is he in fact a prophet? And he said yes. And he entered the first heaven where he met Adam alayhi salam. And they exchanged the greetings. And Adam alayhi salam welcomed him in the first heaven. Then in the second heaven, the same process happened. They had to seek permission. And then in this second heaven, he met Isa and Yahya alayhim assalam. And in the third heaven, Yusuf alayhi salam. In the fourth heaven, Idris alayhi salam. The fifth one, Harun alayhi salam. The sixth one, Musa alayhi salam. And then finally in the seventh, Ibrahim alayhi salam. When he met Musa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam was crying. And he asked him, what made you cry? And he replied that a young man was sent as a prophet after me, and he will have more people in Jannah from his ummah than my ummah. And then after that, he was raised up to the Sidratul Muntaha, which is a tree at the top of Jannah. He says the leaves were like ears of elephants. And he also saw four rivers. Two were hidden from him, so he couldn't make out what these rivers were, but two were clearly visible. The visible ones, he was told, are the Nile and the Furat, the Nile and Euphrates, and two other rivers being rivers of Jannah. Thereafter, he was given two cups, one of khamar, intoxicant, and the other one of milk. And he chose the milk And he was told, you have been guided to the fitra, to the natural goodness. In a version of Sahih Muslim, this milk or khamr choice was given after he prayed in Bayt al-Maqdis. The next question to ask is that when the Prophet met these other prophets, did he meet their physical bodies or was it just their spirit? There are two opinions. The first one says that he met their spirit and body just as normal people. The evidence is that this is what is apparent from these narrations. The second opinion says that he met them in their spirit or their soul and not their physical body. Except for Isa alayhi salam, who was raised up by Allah Jalla wa Ala, so he met Isa alayhi salam in his physical body and the soul. But we can say that the asl is that the prophets have been buried, so their physical body will be in the grave. And there's nothing weird or unreasonable about saying that the Prophet met them in terms of their spirit. But in any case, these are matters of the unseen, and like we've said before, we don't need to delve into the how of the matter. The next matter to discuss is that the narration also talks about Al-Baytul Ma'mur, the populated house. The Prophet saw these amazing signs, like the Baytul Ma'mur, the Sidratul Muntaha, with his heart and his eyes. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ مَا رَأَى. The heart did not lie about what it saw. Likewise, he says, مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى. The vision did not deviate from its fixed place, nor did it look at something it was not supposed to look at. And this proves to us the extreme etiquettes the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام had before his Rabb, that he did not even look at anything else which was not shown to him. Look at the etiquettes. Imagine you walk into a wonderful castle with glorious monuments here, there, and everywhere. How will you be reacting? Well, it seems the average person is going to react by looking at everything to his left, to his right, above him, below him, just marveling and gasping at the wonders laid before him. This would appear to be the normal reaction. But as for the Prophet ﷺ, he only saw that which was shown to him. So whatever was before him, he solely looked at that. He did not even move his eyes left or right, looking at anything else which was not shown to him. So ponder over this immaculate etiquette the Prophet ﷺ had before his Rabb. But did the Prophet ﷺ see Allah Jalla wa Ala himself? And there's no doubt the correct opinion here is that he did not see Allah Jalla wa Ala. In fact, the Prophet answers that question himself in the authentic hadith where he says, Nurun fa'anna ara. It was light, how could I see him? Meaning the hijab of Allah was light, you cannot see through it. However, the Prophet did hear the speech of Allah Jalla wa Ala when he was ordered with the salah. And this brings us on to our next talking point, the five times prayer being ordained. In the beginning, they were 50 prayers, and the Prophet returned, and Musa alayhi salam told him to reduce it. So then the Prophet asked Jibreel alayhi salam if he could negotiate. Then Jibreel allowed him, and the Prophet asked Allah Jalla wa Ala to reduce it. And they were reduced to 40, and this cycle then repeated 30, 20, 10, until they were reduced to 5. And then after that, the Prophet was too embarrassed to ask for any more reduction, even though Musa alayhi salam insisted that they should be reduced even from 5. The Shaykh Abu Ja'far rahimahullah ends the piece by saying that may Allah send his salah and his salam upon the Prophet in the akhirah and in this life. The salah of Allah Jalla wa Ala is simply when Allah makes high or praiseworthy mention of you to the angels. As for salah from the humans or from angels, then this simply means making dua. But can we say alayhi salatu wasalam to somebody other than a prophet? Well, this dua, when you say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you ask Allah to give salah to him, meaning make good mention of him to the highest angels. This is reserved for prophets and messengers, and it should not be done for other than a prophet and messenger as a habitual practice, but it is permissible to do it as a one-off. So one ought not to say Allahumma salli ala Ali Muhammad, O Allah, send salah upon the followers of Muhammad, but rather one can mention them if they follow the Prophet. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Ali Muhammad. So you're asking for Salah to be sent on Muhammad and then on his followers. So the followers are in following the Prophet. So then the Salah can be made for them. Or for example, if you say Sallallahu ala Sahaba, may Allah send his Salah upon the Sahaba. This ought not to be done, but if the Sahaba, you make them follow the Prophet in this sentence, then this is permissible. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ashabihi. So this is fine. As for sending the Salah on other than the Prophet, then we have evidence that the Prophet himself did this when one of his companions, Abu Awfa, brought the zakah to him. The Prophet said, Allahumma salli ala Ali Abi Awfa. O Allah, send your Salah upon the family of Abu Awfa. So even though it is permissible, it should not be made into a habitual practice.
Just the final point about the Mi'raj. Ibn Kathir has a narration in his book Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya that the Prophet said, ثُمَّ اسْتَيْقَظْتُ فَإِذَا أَنَا فِي الْحِجْرِ. Then I woke up and I was in the Hijr. And this is pertaining to the night journey. It implies that all this experience of the ascension was in his dream, because it says, then I woke up. However, it is worth noting that Ibn Kathir says that this is a mistake from the narrator, Shariq. So this narration cannot be relied upon. And rather, what is the truth, as mentioned before, is that this experience was both with the body and soul.
Then the Shaykh goes on to say, وَالْحَوْضُ الَّذِي أَكْرَمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى بِهِ غِيَاثًا لِأُمَّتِهِ حَقٌّ. And the basin which Allah has honored the Prophet with to save his ummah with is the truth. So this sentence speaks about the hawd in other parts of our iman. So firstly, let it be known that the hawd, the basin from which the mu'minun will drink the water of al-kawthar, which is a stream which runs from Jannah, this is again a matter of the unseen. Hence, we cannot delve into how it will happen and all these minor niggly details. We just have to take the information or this news item on its surface value and have iman in it that this is the truth. And it must be known that the first description given about the mu'minun in the Quran is that they have iman in the ghaib, in the unseen. This is the description even before their description of establishing the prayer and giving the zakah and all these other righteous works. None of this is given priority. The priority is given to having iman in the unseen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. So the iman in the ghaib comes even before establishing the salah and giving the zakah. And it also needs to be known that the ahadith and narrations speaking about the hawd have reached a mutawatir level in terms of their meaning. More than 50 sahaba have narrated a hadith about the hawd. The people of Bid'ah have disagreed about the hawd. The Khawarij, the Rawafid, and the Mu'tazila disagree. The Mu'tazila completely reject the hawd. The Rawafid and the Khawarij do affirm the hawd, but they understand it in a different way. We are told in the text that Allah has honored the Prophet with the hawd. We have evidence to believe that Allah has honored every Prophet with a specific hawd or a basin for that Prophet, as in the hadith, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ حَوْضًا. For every Prophet there is a hawd. This hadith is in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, graded sahih by a Shaykh al-Albani. The Shaykh uses the word غِيَاثًا, which means to give water. So when you are suffering a drought, ghayth would come when you are in some distress, when there is no water, and hence no crop. And when this rain is sent down, this is the ghayth. And so what he's referring to is that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, people will be very thirsty, and they will be in dire need of water. And this is ghayth, when water comes to you when you are in dire need of it. We are told about the period of time where the people will be on the plains of Yawm al-Qiyamah. It will be to the amount of 50,000 years of our reckoning. And it will not be 50,000 years of comfort living, it will be 50,000 years of distress. When the sun will be drawn close, the mother and father will be running away even from their own children and their brothers and their close loved ones. The pregnant woman will drop her load out of fear. Everyone will be naked, but no one will notice this because of the intensity of distress and fear. So one cannot even imagine the frights of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Let's take some talking points here. Firstly, the evidence for the Hawd. Well, we have the Qur'an and the Sunnah. As far as the Qur'an is concerned, إِنَّا أَعْضَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ Verily, we have granted you the Kawthar, and that's a river of water in Jannah. Now, the tafasir of this Kawthar tell us this is a river in Jannah, and we also know that there are some pipes which lead the Kawthar river into the Hawd of the Prophet. As for the ahadith, then they are mutawatir in their number, in terms of the meaning, as opposed to the mutawatir in wording, because you can have two types of mutawatir. Mutawatir in meaning and mutawatir in wording. The ahadith are actually also mutawatir in their wording as well. So if that's the case, then they reach the level of the Qur'an, because the Qur'an is mutawatir in wording and naturally in meaning as well. Because if you're mutawatir in wording, then you have to be mutawatir in meaning. It just follows naturally. But the other way around is not true. If the narration is mutawatir in its general meaning, it doesn't have to be mutawatir in its actual wording, because you can say the same thing in different words. And the Sahaba who have reported it are the Sahaba of the greatest eminence, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar, Abu Dharr, and many others, radiallahu anhum. The next point to speak about is the description of the Hawd. It has been said that it is a square shape. In the Sahih, the Prophet described it, طوله شهر وعرضه شهر وزواياه سواء. Its length is a month's journey, its width is a month's journey, and its corners are all equal. This would suggest to us it is a square shape, because the square has all its sides of equal length by definition. There are other narrations which speak about the lengths. Some narrations say, هو كما بين المدينة وبيت المقدس. It is like between Medina and Jerusalem. Other narrations speak about between Medina and Umman. Others, between Medina and Sana'a, which is the capital of Yemen. Others speak about what is between Ayla and Sana'a. And there are other narrations yet. Okay, now where will it be? This is another question. Well, it will be on the plains of Yawm al-Qiyamah. This earth will be changed into another type of earth. So today we see the earth, it is the earth of this world, or this life. But the earth will change on Yawm al-Qiyamah to the earth of the afterlife. And Allah Jalla wa'ala speaks about changing or transforming this earth and the heavens into a different form. And thirdly, we can speak about its cups from which you drink. The Prophet said, "Aniyatuhu kanujum as-sama." Its cups are like the stars of the sky. Well, first of all, this could mean in terms of their number. If you look into the sky, you will not be able to count the number of stars. But it can also mean in terms of their splendor and their luster and beauty. Its water, which is in the Hawd, has been described. The Prophet said, "Hawdi tuluhu shahr wa arduhu shahr." مَاؤُهُ أَشَدُّ بَيَاضًا مِنَ اللَّبَنِ وَأَحْلَى مِنَ الْعَصَلِ My Hawd is 1 month's journey length and 1 month's journey width-wise. Its water is whiter than milk and sweeter than honey. Also, it has been mentioned, رَائِحَتُهُ كَرَائِحَةِ الْمِسْكِ Its scent is like the scent of misk, which is a type of perfume. And we are also told that two pipes will bring this water of Kawthar into the Hawd. The other question we ask is, what about the order of events on Yawm al-Qiyamah? Well, some scholars said that this Hawd will take place before the passing over the Sirat. The evidence they use is that some people will be taken away from the Hawd and the Prophet will say, Rabbi, Ashabi, Ashabi, my Rabb, these are my companions. And he will be told, لا تدري ما أحدثوا بعدك. You do not know what they newly invented after you. So these people will be taken away into the fire. So that would suggest that this is before the Sirat. Because after the Sirat, those people who are going to fall into the fire would have fell into the fire. The other opinion is that the Hawd will be twice. One before the Sirat and one afterwards. So those who did not drink from it first time round and were punished will come back after their punishment, after they have been purified, and get to drink from it. And so the second time round is after the Sirat. But what is apparent from the narration is that it is going to be once and before the Sirat. Okay, will it be before the Mizan or after? The Mizan being the scales when your deeds are weighed. Most scholars say it will be before the Mizan, and also before the scriptures are given to the people, either in their right hand or their left hand. And we are also told that anyone who drinks from the Hawd will never be thirsty again. So all these times then that the people of Jannah will be drinking from the rivers of Jannah, it will not be because of thirst. It will be purely because of pleasure. The next talking point is about the hadith in Sahih Muslim with the Prophet ﷺ. He's going to see some of the people coming to his Hawd, but they will be taken away. And he will say, "My Rabb, these are my companions." There will be a second type of people who will be deprived from the Hawd, and these are the type of people whom the Prophet will shoo away himself, because they are not from his Ummah. So as for the one he's going to shoo away himself, then he would want these people to go to their own Prophets to drink from that Hawd. But as for those from his Ummah who will be taken away, and the Prophet will be wondering, why are they taken away? He'll say, "These are my companions." In another wording, he will say, "These are from my Ummah." And he will be told, "You do not know the new things which they did after you." And in another narration, it says, "Innahum lam yazalu murtaddina ala adbarihim mudh taraktahum." They became kuffar after you left them. So the scholars have asked the question, who are these people then who will be turned away? One opinion says these will be those people during the time of the Prophet who entered Islam but then became kuffar by following people like Musaylimah al-Kadhab, Musaylimah, who claimed to be a prophet. And these are only a few people. And what indicates that they are few in number is that the Prophet says, فَيَأْتِينِي قَوْمٌ يُذَادُونَ عَنِ الْحَوْضِ. So they will come to me a people who will be taken away from the Hawd. So this people refers to a small group of people. So those of the companions of the Prophet, who were contemporaries of the Prophet, but they embraced kufr afterwards, were very small in number. The second opinion is that these people will be the munafiqun, those who outwardly displayed their Islam, but inwardly they were kuffar. Now the Prophet did not know all of the munafiqeen. He was informed of the names of some of the munafiqeen, but he did not know all of them. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Muhammad, وَلَوْ نَشَاءُ لَأَرَيْنَاكَهُمْ فَلَعَرَفْتَهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ وَلَا تَعْرِفَنَّهُمْ فِي لَحْنِ الْقَوْلِ. If we had so willed, we would have shown them to you, so you would have known them by their features. So in other words, Allah saying, if he had willed, he would have shown them to you, and you would have known them just by looking at them by their features. But he goes on to say, but you will surely recognize them by the style of their speech. You can tell just by the style of somebody's speech if he is a true mu'min or not. So the discerning mind can tell who has iman and who doesn't. You can tell by what they say and how they say it, and what type of language they use, and the words that are used. The lahan in the qawl, the lahan in your speech, normally lahan refers to making grammatical mistakes, but that is not what is intended here. Lahan intended here is the crookedness of their speech. So we take from that the Prophet could not tell who the munafiqeen are just by looking at them, so he may look at someone and deem them to be a Muslim. There is a third opinion which says that these were the innovators, because the hadith says you don't know what new things they brought about after you left them. Now, even though these statements, three of them, as we have mentioned, are different, there's not necessarily a contradiction between them, because actually we could accept all of these statements. So it is not the case that these people are necessarily kuffar. They could be from the mubtadi'un, from the innovators, and those who changed the deen. There is an authentic hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, authenticated by Shaykh al-Albani, where the Prophet said, سَيَكُونُ بَعْدِي أُمَرَىٰ فَمَنْ صَدَّقَهُمْ بِكَذِبِهِمْ وَأَعَانَهُمْ عَلَىٰ ظُلْمِهِمْ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي وَلَسْتُ مِنْهُ وَلَنْ يَرِدْ عَلَيَّ الْحَوْضُ. After me there will be leaders. So whoever believes them in their lies and helps them in their transgression, then he is not from me and I am not from him, and he will not come to my Hawd. So the hadith says whoever believes them in their lies. So these are the lies in the deen. And so he believes it and helps them in propagating these lies in the deen and changing the deen. As for the Rawafid Shia, who make takfir on most of the Sahaba, they're going to be using the hadith of the Hawd to justify their belief that the Sahaba turned into kuffar after the Prophet. But no attention needs to be paid to such foolishness. The people of Bid'ah, their methodology is to take a hadith which could be used to support their view and refuse to look at the evidence as a whole. So refusing to look at all of the evidences. Rather, they just highlight the ones that support their madhab. So no attention needs to be paid to them. Okay, the next talking point is about the viewpoint of the Ahlul Bid'ah regarding the Hawd. So as for the Mu'tazila, they just, from the very beginning, deny the Hawd. And as for all of these narrations, which we said have reached a mutawatir level, then the Mu'tazila simply have rejected them all in favor of their own intellect. They simply say that the Hawd, it cannot be understood to be a physical basin, but rather it is something non-physical. They say, how can there be a basin which has a river from Jannah flowing into it? It doesn't make sense. And how can there be a path, the Sirat, which passes over Jahannam? And Jahannam is so huge and so massive, do you expect to traverse across Jahannam on this particular path, on this Sirat? This makes no sense. So you can see where they are going wrong. The description that has been mentioned in the text regarding the Hawd, regarding the Sirat, and all these other events, these people, the Mu'tazila, are imagining them in their minds, and it is not making sense to them. And because of that, they are rejecting what is apparent from the text. And herein lies their mistake. Whereas what was upon them is to take the text as it comes without trying to imagining it. Because you simply would not be able to imagine it. And how do you know that this imagination of yours in your mind, this picture that you formed, is in fact the way it is going to happen? How do you know this imagination of yours is accurate in the ways these events will manifest? You simply have no way of knowing. Your imagination is not a source of knowledge. The text of the Quran and the authentic Sunnah are a source of knowledge. Let us just remind ourselves of what we are speaking of here. We are speaking of the matter of the unseen. Therefore, our intellects don't have a role to play when deciding how things will manifest or when trying to figure out the complete meaning of these words. Because it's not like these matters can be studied any further such that we can know the complete meaning. Rather, all we know is the original or the basic meaning of these words. That's as far as we can go with these affairs. Remember, when it comes to words and concepts, we have a basic meaning, a complete meaning, and the kayfiyah or the how of it, meaning how it manifests. Three categories, and when it comes to matters of the unseen, we can only go as far as the first category, which is the basic meaning. And some of the ulama said that the one who rejects the hawd, after he knows that the narrations have reached a mutawatir level, then he has committed kufr. But what saves the Mu'tazila from committing kufr is that they do not reject the hawd in terms of the concept. What they reject is the apparent meaning of the word hawd, which means basin. So they accept it, but they interpret it in their fashion of interpretation, which of course is invalid without a shadow of doubt. And then we have the Rawafid Shia. The Rawafid, they say that the Sahaba will be taken away from the Hawd, and this will of course be a large group because the Sahaba of course are a large group. So the Rawafid do believe in the Hawd, but they say that the Sahaba are going to be prevented from the Hawd. However, like we said before, the wording of the Hadith tells us that the people who will be turned away from the Hawd, and the Prophet is going to say, "My Rabb, these are my companions," then the number of these people is going to be a small number. The word used is qawm, a people. And secondly, and more interestingly, is that the Sahaba who have reported the ahadith of the Hawd are the very Sahaba the Rafida make takfir on. So it immediately begs the question to the Rafida, how are you accepting the hadith reported by a kafir? And if it is the case, as the Rafida claim, that these Sahaba who will be taken away from the Hawd or prevented is going to be a large number, or even most of the Sahaba, then that would mean that all of these Sahaba reporting these ahadith are in fact reporting that they are going to become kuffar. But of course, no one of the Sahaba, or even the followers of the Sahaba, understood this hadith in that way. And the basic rule that we follow is that if there is a hadith that has been reported by the Sahaba, and then thereafter, meaning after the time of the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, there come a people who understand this particular hadith in a newly invented way or in a new way which was not understood in the same way by the Sahaba or the Tabi'een, then this new understanding is to be rejected. So that is to say that we understand the Qur'an and the authentic hadith in the same way that the Sahaba understood it. And we do not invent newer ways of understanding and interpreting these hadith or ayat. So it means that these companions who will be turned away will be a small number who did not truly have iman in their heart. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, وَمِمَّنْ حَوْلَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ مُنَافِقُونَ وَمِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ مَرَدُوا عَلَى النِّفَاقِ لَا تَعْلَمُهُمْ نَحْنُ نَعْلَمُهُمْ. And from those of the Arab around you, there are munafiqeen. And from those who are residing in Al-Madina, who are just dedicated to their hypocrisy, you do not know them, O Prophet, but we know them. So yes, there will be some people whom the Prophet will think are his companions because he thinks that they are Muslims. But Allah Jalla wa Ala knows who they really are. And then, like we said before, the Rafida do not look at all of the evidences regarding the Sahaba. They just look at this evidence, interpret it the way they want to, and rejoice. Oh look, we have evidence that all of the Sahaba, or most of them, are kuffar. Look at this hadith of the Hawd. But they do not look at other evidences where Allah says, Radiallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. And such words cannot be uttered about kuffar. What is upon us to do is to bring all the evidences together and reconcile between them. This is the way of the Ahlul Sunnah. The Ahlul Bid'ah always give more weight to an evidence which could be used to support their madhab. They never give equal treatment to all of the evidences. They never bring all of the evidences together and look at it as a whole. This you will find to be the methodology of all of the Ahlul Bid'ah. So we say to anyone who wants to drink from the Hawd is that you stick to the Sunnah and you do not innovate anything in the deen. And you do not believe or fabricate lies in this deen. Remember the hadith in Sunan At-Tirmidhi which we quoted about there being rulers or leaders, and whoever believes them in their lies or helps them in their transgression, the Prophet says that he is not from me and I am not from him, and he will not come to the Hawd. So those who lie against Allah Jalla wa Ala in this deen are the Ahlul Bid'ah. Al-Imam As-Saffarini says in his poem of the Aqidah, عَنْهُ يُذَادُ الْمُفْتَرِي كَمَا وَرَدْ وَمَنْ نَحَى سُبُلَ السَّلَامَةِ لَمْ يُرَدْ. From it, meaning from the Hawd, the one who fabricated lies will be prevented, and the one who took the ways of peace will not be rejected. Next, the Shaykh speaks about الشفاعة, the intercession, where he says, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ وَالشَّفَاعَةُ الَّتِي دَخَرَهَا لَهُمْ حَقٌّ كَمَا رُوِيَ فِي الْأَخْبَارِ. And the shafa'ah, the intercession, which the Prophet has stored for them, is the truth as it has been narrated in the narrations. Notice he says the Prophet has stored it for them. He's referring to the hadith in the Sahih, where the Prophet said, لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ دَعْوَةٌ مُجَابَةٌ وَإِنِّي اخْتَبَأْتُ دَعْوَةِ شَفَاعَةً لِأُمَّتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Every Prophet has a dua which is definitely going to be answered. But as for me, I have kept hidden this special dua for me, not to use in this world, but to use on Yawm al-Qiyamah as an intercession for my ummah. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet, who has most right to your intercession? And the Prophet replied, Man qala la ilaha illallahu khalisan min qalbih. The one who says la ilaha illallah sincerely from his heart. Let's take some talking points. Firstly, the word ash-shafa'a in the language comes from ash-shafa', which means even. And so the intercession is all about when you intercede for someone, so you become this person's partner, you become even. So it's two, whereas before, this person needing intercession was just by himself. As for technically, it is the general term referring to the dua which the Prophet is going to make on Yawm al-Qiyamah for his ummah. And this is because a shafa'ah, intercession, is when you ask on someone else's behalf for something that will bring about a benefit to him or ward off a harm from him, meaning from the person on whose behalf you are making intercession. Now the shafa'a which the Shaykh is speaking about is the shafa'atul uzma, the great shafa'a on yawm al-qiyamah. Because one can make shafa'a even in this life, people can make shafa'a for each other. The Prophet ﷺ said, ishfa'u tu'jaru, make shafa'a for each other, you will be rewarded. وَلْيَقْضِ اللَّهُ عَلَى لِسَانِ نَبِيِّهِ مَا شَاءَ, and let Allah judge through the tongue of his Prophet whatever he wants to. So even the Prophet ordered his companions to make intercession for each other. This is making intercession for that which is good, of course, as opposed to making intercession to help each other to commit evil. But as for the intercession of the hereafter, then the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij have rejected a type of intercession, which is an intercession made by the Prophet for the people of major sins. That is to bring them out of Jahannam. That is because they say that the one who died upon major sins is going to be in Jahannam forever because he's a kafir. Our next talking point is to speak about the shafa'a, which the Prophet will have exclusively. And this is the shafa'atul uzma, the great shafa'a. This is basically where the Prophet is going to ask Allah Jalla wa'ala to pass judgment on Yawm al-Qiyamah, because the people will be in distress on the plains of Yawm al-Qiyamah. They would just want this all to end. So they would want the judgment to be passed because of the distress. So for 50,000 years, people will be in distress. They would want this to end. So they would want the judgment to be passed. And as the hadith states in the Sahih, the people will go to Adam alayhi salam to intercede on their behalf. He will refuse and he will remember his sin. And they will go to Nuh alayhi salam and he will refuse. And they will go to Ibrahim alayhi salam, he will refuse. They will go to Musa alayhi salam, he will refuse. They will go to Isa alayhi salam, he will also refuse. Until they end up with the last prophet, and he will say, ana laha, I am for it, I am for it. And he will fall prostrate underneath the arsh, and he will praise Allah with a special type of praise which Allah will teach him. And then he will be told, raise your head, ask and you will be given, intercede, and your intercession will be accepted. And this hadith is a tafsir of the ayah, asa an yaba'athaka rabbuka maqaman mahmuda. It may be that your Rabb raises you to the praised station. And this praised station is the ability to intercede in this ash-shafa'atul uzma, the great shafa'ah. And also the dua made after the adhan, Allahumma rabba hadhihi ad-da'wati at-tammah was-salati al-qa'imah, aati Muhammadan al-wasilata wal-fadilah, وَبَعَثْهُ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا الَّذِي وَعَدْتَ. It ends by saying, and send him to the praised station which you promised him. This praised station is the ability to perform the الشَّفَاعَةُ uzma. And so this dua, this shafa'a, will be for the whole of mankind.
Yet further showing us that the Prophet ﷺ will be the leader of mankind. Okay, let us take a few review questions at this stage. Question number one. Give three reasons for thinking that the Prophet was taken up on the night journey, both in body and soul, as opposed to just a soul or just it being a vision. Question number two. The Prophet rode the Buraq. Give two reasons why the Buraq is so called. Question number three. There are three opinions, though not contradictory, about the type of people who will be turned away from the Hawd. Who are these types of people?